My talk is a little bit related in the subject to the first talk of the session. If you're here, you'll see some similarities on some topics. But today I'm going to talk about hierarchical wavelet-based turbulence modeling. And because of the, for most of you probably it will be unfamiliarity to the subject, it's not common stream approach, I will try to talk more on philosophical high level without providing some details. And if you're interested, I mean, you can talk after the session or anytime we have left in the conference, you know, I can fill you in the details or provide you references. So this is the list of my collaborators, you know, university collaborators, former students, postdocs working with me while I was at the University of Colorado, and students and postdocs of my collaborators in different universities, who one way or another contributed to the subject of this talk. So the plan of the talk, I will talk about motivation, I will talk about new paradigm that we are pursuing of direct physics-based coupling of adaptive numerical models and turbulence modeling. Talk about the, briefly about parallel adaptive wavelet collocation method, because this is essential methodology which is used not only for numerical simulations but also for modeling. And then once I describe this mathematical framework briefly, I will talk about hierarchical turbulence modeling. In particular, you will see there's a four types in this hierarchically, start from the wavelet-based direct numerical simulations, then coherent vortex simulation, following an adaptive large eddy simulation, which is, in one sense, it is similar to LES, but it has some fundamental philosophical difference. We'll discuss about that, and then talk about low fidelity approaches. And in the end, I'll talk about what we try to do in the future, try to glue all this together. So now, most of you are aware of LES, but let me simply briefly say what it is, so I put my talk in perspective. So with larger eddy simulations, you take the velocity field and decompose into the two components, large scale component and small scale contribution. Then you filter the Navier-Stokes equations, and you end up having with the term which is unclosed, and you have to model that term. So if you think about the kind of what people do, you can put it into the kind of diagram, dependency the diagram for the simulation diagram. You have a CFD engine typically, then you have some grid scale model, then you have a grid filtering definition, then you have a numerical mesh, and if it is and then provide a filter width, if it is explicit filtering, or if it is implicit filtering, very often this mesh, the filter width is a function of your local mesh resolution, and you get results. This is basically the block diagram of the classical LES method. And if you see here, the main thing which I want to show you that the, typically the simulation engine is independent of subgrid scale model. What people do, people do, take a computational tool, take the model, plug together, and want to get results. And more or less the same is done for the RANS approach, for anything more or less common nowadays. So what is now the main deficiencies of classical LES? There are, number one is that classical LES does not take advantage of the main turbulence features, intermittency. Beforehand, you decide the flow is large or small, and you basically don't take advantage. As a result, what happens, your flow fields on the LES don't have uniform fidelity. You know, in some regions of the flow, you have very, very important regions, you have under resolution. In some regions where nothing's going on, you have over resolution. And then the main issue with the classical LES, you a priori decide what is large, what is wrong. While in reality, what is really, you're going after dynamically important structures. And the scale of them depends on the flow, particular locations, particular moment in time, and particular structures in the flow field. So what we're pursuing different direction, you can call philosophy, paradigm, where we directly coupling our numerical, adaptive numerical methods with the turbulence modeling. That line of the message was given in the first talk of the message. So the idea is that we want to be our numerics to be aware of the numerical model, and we want to be numerical model to be aware of numerics. They go together, take advantage of each other, and compensate of deficiency if necessary for each other. So now, if you want to develop this type of approach, we need to have active control of fidelity, have adaptive coherential mesh to do that, then we have to basically be able to capture desired flow physics, and then we have to have basically more method producing, end up producing, you know, reasonable, better scaling than classical methods. And most important, you have to have adaptive mesh refinement methods to do that. So let's start with the adaptive wavelet methods which we developed to give you perspective what we're trying to do, more or less capabilities what we have that allow us to pursue this research. So the idea we have to do with the adaptive mesh refinement. So this is, since lots of talks were talking about relay tail instability, here's an example of relay tail instability, model mole fraction, you know, density, vorticity. But most important, what is I want to show you here is mesh. Mesh is scaled by levels of resolution. The higher level, the finer it is. And what you see, if you see the structure of the mesh more or less mimics the structure of the flow. So the idea, we want to put the mesh points only where it's necessary. So this is another example, simple example, flow around the cylinder. You see, once again, we put the mesh points in the vortex street only where we need it. This is now why, and the question that you want to do is say, we want to use wavelets for that. And the question is, why we want to use wavelets? And there are, wavelets have four particular properties. Number one, they're good in image compression. Number two, their algorithms are very fast. And they're good denoising the signals, and they're also very good in recognition, feature recognition. So the first two features we use to construct numerical methods, and the second two we use for model for modeling. And once combined together, they have a nice uniform framework, hierarchical framework for wavelet-based turbulence modeling. So those of you who are not familiar with wavelets, here kind of a brief example which tells you about why wavelets are good in image compression. On the left, I will keep original image. This is Relay-Billard instability convection. On the right, I will have a use wavelet compressed image. So here, I use 1/5 of the wavelet coefficients, basically only 20% information, but you don't see the difference, basically identical results. Use 6% of the wavelet coefficients, and you still see only small difference, but practically still capture the fields. Even less than 1%, all the major features are captured quite well. Only if you continue beyond, you start losing the approximation. So this is a posterior analysis of the solution. What we're after, we want to get the solution right away on the fly in compressed solution. So why wavelets? Because the wavelets, compared to classical methods, they actually have very nice property. If you compare wavelets to the, let's say, Fourier expansions, Fourier is very good localizations in wave number space and very unlocal behavior in physical space. Finite difference, finite volumes, finite element, the opposite. They have very good localization in physical space and bad in wave number space. Wavelets, they have near-optimal behavior because they are localized in wave number space and also localized, in this case, exponential decay in wave number space. So that means if I have a coefficient of wavelet expansion, and this coefficient has is large, that means at that location k and at level j, there is something going on. So this is contrast with Fourier transform. As I mentioned, you completely lose locality of your information. So now if I take my, if I put the wavelets from the basis by dilating and translating your original wavelet, and you can see this how it looks like. The higher scale, the smaller the wavelets are. So then if I decompose my, let's say, signal with sharp transition, what I have, I basically decompose the wavelet coefficients, and here, at each location, I will have to basically find my wavelet coefficient. But what is important, only few of these locations where wavelet coefficients is large. So in this particular case, I showed marked in red coefficients which are above 10 minus 3. And so what is a more important property of wavelets which allows us to do the adaptation is that the difference between the original signal and that truncated signal using wavelet truncation is controlled by this threshold parameter epsilon. Smaller it is, the less is error. Larger, the more is error. That allows us to active control the accuracy of our simulation. If you compare the decomposition of wavelets with the Fourier, you see Fourier have a mode. Wavelets have bands because, once again, it is kind of local wave number space, localized, but it's not a delta function. If you do Fourier cutoff filter, you do sharp cutoff, for example, you keep the low wave number modes and throw out high frequency modes, which is done in LAS. With the wavelet thresholding, you keep the most energetic, most dominant modes, which are marked in red, and throw out the noise, or less energetic, less coherent structures. This is an example of what adaptation does, once again. To give you an idea, you see, this is a simple example of Burgers equations. You see, as the small scales appears, you have more and more points at the finer scale. The same is when you have structure moves around. This is just want to show you how the mesh changes at different levels of resolution. This is more complicated example that shows you, this is the basically generation initiation process. You can see very big domain, nothing is going on here. You only put the mesh points where necessary, and you track your solutions on adaptive mesh and resolve all the scales as necessary. So now you more or less get an idea of numerics which method we develop. Next step is the topic of my talk, hierarchical wavelet-based turbulence modeling. So the idea is originally was suggested by Marie Farsh, where she took the vorticity decomposed into two parts, which at that point she called coherent and incoherent. And at that point was not, I mean, for people who deal with turbulence, the definition of coherency was not really clear. So, but then if you decompose them using wavelet denoising procedure, then there is an optimal threshold exists. And with this optimal threshold, you can decompose original field into the coherent and incoherent. And then you can show that this incoherent field, why it is really incoherent, because it is Gaussian white noise. And she was able to, with her collaborators, to show that for the different applications, but mostly in the for homogeneous turbulence, that the flow is incoherent and Gaussian white noise because it is K squared. And you see, and that if you compare the PDF of vorticity with Gaussian, you can see this is your Gaussian PDF mimics quite well. Now, so now that was kind of motivating work of her. But now, let's say we take the velocity field and start decomposing in terms of wavelet expansion. So the value of this threshold parameter affects everything. So remember, my wavelet coefficient, wavelet functions are localized in physical and wave number space. So we decompose our velocity field in terms of dominant structures, filtered, which are kept by wavelet thresholding, and less dominant structures. And the choice of this threshold basically controls at what level of you are. If your epsilon is very small, you are the now, at the level of direct numerical simulations, which we call wavelet-based numerical simulations, the WDNS, in such a way that basically all these basically features below epsilon can be neglected and they don't contribute to dynamics of the solution. Coherent vortex simulations, it's an optimal threshold parameter where you resolve coherent structures. And what was shown, that because incoherent structures, they don't really, they're incoherent. You can basically don't even need to put model for momentum transport because the contribution to subgrid scale model is almost zero. And then, but if epsilon is larger, we are going to the limit similar to LAS, where you cannot no longer neglect the effect of that small of the filtered motions. You have to model the effect on large scales or on the modes that you kept. So one way to understand this process, if you think about this dependency diagram, if you put the basically square, in this axis you think about these wave numbers, on this axis you put about wavelet threshold. So if you have basically all the square, that means you resolve everything. So here think about it, Kolmogorov length scale, something like that. So if you keep all the scales, we resolve everything. So now here, there is this optimal threshold, which separates coherent structures, both small and large, and incoherent ones. And now, if you think classical LAS, is that we do vertical line at given wave number. So this is filtered out modes, and this is resolved large scales. And basically, as an LAS, we have to model subgrid scale crest depending on the level of epsilon. If epsilon is very small, that effect is negligible. We can throw it away. And then you end up getting direct numerical simulations. Here's an example of vortex shading from the cylinder at Reynolds number 500. This is the same thing with the mesh superimposed. And you can see the region of high level of resolution where you have, where you put where these things are happening. This is an example of the flow around sphere. Now, if you do the mentioned coherent vortex simulations, you can neglect this effect of MI. And if you do epsilon latch, which we talk about adaptive latch ID simulations, you have to model that effect. Now, that is a very educational slide. Let's look at the, this is a posteriori studies. You run direct numerical simulations, in this case it was done by spectral methods, and then you use wavelets to decompose your fields into the coherent incoherent contribution using wavelet decomposition. And that's what you find is, if you calculate the subgrid scale dissipation coming from all the modes, which is blue, that will be your black, then only from the coherent modes and incoherent modes. And what you notice that you have less than 5% of coherent modes, and the rest, 95%, is incoherent ones. And then you know that the subgrid scale dissipation really mimics the full dissipation. What it means that only coherent modes are really responsible for subgrid scale dissipation, at least in the context of homogeneous turbulence. And also that means that actually explains why LAS works. If all the dissipation comes from incoherent modes, it will be impossible to come up with a subgrid scale model that will use large scale velocity field and model the effect of small scales. The fact that they're coherent, that's what makes it work. And the same actually true for a classical LAS. So now, what we are after, we are now similar to LAS, we are resolving scales, but we are resolving energy dominant structures and model effect of less dominant structures. And we have different numbers of models because there is no homogeneous direction anymore. We don't want to do averaging. So all the models are either local or we'll do Lagrangian path line averaging. So this is, I mean, you can get details in the papers which published. So now, if you compare to the original diagram, remember I showed about LAS, the thing is slightly different now. We have this adaptive wavelet collocation solver. We have subgrid scale model, grid. But now, what happens, results of simulations, they come back to the grid filter because the grid filter depends on flow realization. Remember this norm, it is truncation filter. It's no longer linear filter, it's nonlinear filter. And that's what is different. Of course, you have numerical epsilon filtering, similar to what people use in LAS as a numerical mesh and filtered with. But the main difference now have a feedback. The next question which we want to ask is the following. When you fix epsilon, you only basically, truncate your velocity field. But the question I want to ask, we want to fix fidelity, what it means by we want to fix turbulent resolution. Of course, the question would be, what is turbulent resolution? And there are multiple ways to do that. One way to think about it as the ratio of subgrid scale kinetic energy versus total kinetic energy, turbulent kinetic energy. Another way to think about it, it is subgrid scale dissipation versus total dissipation. So from looking at this, I mean, it doesn't really make any difference, both of the measurements of kinetic energy. But which one is better quantity for fidelity? This way, it's easy to think about scalability studies. If, for example, you virtually want to do simulations, let's say LAS, and you want to keep fidelity and increase Reynolds number, what will happen? Is if you do classical LAS and you want to keep fidelity based on kinetic energy, what happens? Because the energy spectra goes down, you keep increasing LAS, and at some point, subgrid scale basically resolved kinetic energy is becoming insignificant. So basically, at some point, your fidelity does not depend on Reynolds number. You can increase your Reynolds number, but you effectively, whether you do LAS, finite Reynolds number LAS, or infinite number Reynolds LAS is the same. You won't see the difference. So that means the fidelity based on kinetic energy is not a good measure. A better measure is based on the dissipation. And in this case, what happens is that if you do classical LAS and do that, what happens is that as spectral increasing, you increase your Reynolds number, your peak of dissipation goes up, so does the basically the affiliate cutoff frequency. So, and if you do the scaling, it will be basically like almost the same DNS scaling, except it will be cheaper. It will be parallel, but lower. So now we do differently. We want to do control fidelity locally. And the way it is quite simple. You have this wavelet threshold, which controls resolution. If locally your resolution, if subgrid scale dissipation locally is too high, what does it mean? You're too coarse. Your solution is too coarse. You have to make it finer. And to do that, you simply decrease your epsilon. If subcritical dissipation is too little, that means you're too fine. Your mesh is you need to coarsen the mesh, and to do that, you simply increase your epsilon. That's the whole idea of this controlling local control of fidelity. So, and the way you can do it, you do it more or less in Lagrangian sense. You make a epsilon as a field. You have to track. You can do either track or do simply linear interpolation. But the most important thing, this epsilon needs to also be smooth. And if it is not smooth, that means it can produce high frequency, which will translate into our velocity field. So we have multiple approaches. One approach is direct solving these equations. This is your filter width can be also related to, for example, path tube averaging kind of approach. And then we solve this equation either using direct evolution or using basically characteristics backtracking. And then the idea, for example, we want to run homogeneous turbulence case, and every, let's say, 5 editing over times, we want to change fidelity. We want to have 20% of fidelity, 25, 30, and then let's say jump back to 40, and we can change, see how it goes. And see if we can adjust, if we can control this fidelity in adaptive fashion. Here's an example of our simulations using first order backward interpolation, third order, and then high dissipation diffusion coefficients for our epsilon. And here I show that time when we change fidelity. As you can see, as you change fidelity, epsilon more or less very fast adjusts. You can see right now about, yeah, adjust, either grows or later goes down. And as you can see, if you have more diffusion, it changes smoothly. Less diffusion, it's more oscillatory. Now, if you look on the now average fidelity, if you take the average, remember, we're controlling the local fidelity, but here I'm plotting the global quantities. Average dissipation resolved in subcritical dissipations. So if you locally control your dissipations, then global quantity is also the same. And actually, it's a very good quantity. And as you can see, it goes quite well, but there are two different regimes. One regime is for small diffusion and one for large. And as you can see, if your diffusion is very large, you're off. What it means, if you're smoothing your epsilon too large, it doesn't have time to basically to adapt because you are smoothing details. You have to make it small at the same time, not small enough to create artificial scales. Now, the next question is how to extend this approach to the wall-bounded flows. So the equation is more or less the same, but what we found, if we start solving the equation, now the scaling original idea of feedback mechanism is no longer there. Because if you go to the close to the wall, what happens there, the turbulent kinetic dies, it goes to the viscous sublayer. And what happens if kinetic energy, basically turbulence becomes smaller, but you prescribe fidelity level, what happens is that you want to decrease resolution because it's too coarse. So it's opposite tendency. So you have to distinguish the regions of the low turbulent kinetic energy and the region of low, basically, stress and strain field. And that's what we did. We introduced regions, turbulent region, laminar regions where kinetic energy goes to, where basically strain rates and vorticities are very small, and near wall region where kinetic energy goes to zero. And then you have here, we can see these forcing mechanisms. This is turbulent forcing mechanisms. This is the lamina. You basically see this is more or less active in the lamina region. And here is this, what we call wall region forcing, which is quite active in the wall region, but also away where in the region where low kinetic energy region. And this is composed forcing. Here, the kind of mesh, slice of the mesh for two different goals of subgrid-scale dissipation, 15% turbulence modeling and 5% turbulence modeling. As you can see, this, the less our basically need to model, the more we have to resolve. We have finer mesh there. So this is examples of this approach which we applied. This is the results of the solution compared to the experimental results of Brun. Quite good agreement there. Here you look at the levels of our instantaneous threshold field. You see it's quite noisy. It basically follows the structures for solution. And here, three-dimensional example. Here you have isosurface of epsilon, isosurfaces of vorticity, and this is the mesh. So they all align with each other. This is an example of the flow evolution. This is vorticity, and this is mesh, colored by the level of resolution. So now, what is different now compared to the previous results, we add feedback loop. Based on our local measurement, we estimate our quantities, for example, turbulence resolution, and we change our local mesh spacing, and we change our local subgrid-scale model. So this is different approach, which is basically now we're not only changing the resolution, but we also can change the model as well. So if you take the classical LAS approach, what we're actually doing is also can be modified to fit exactly the same thing. If you think about classical LAS in the context of adaptive mesh refinement, if you provide a feedback loop, similar based on, for example, turbulent resolution, and you can allow change the mesh, you can also change local mesh resolution, and it's becoming basically more or less the same approach. The only difference with wavelets is because wavelets have nice framework where it's easy to do that. But it can be done with any numerical code which you have, provided you have it has adaptivity in it. If you're interested, we can discuss later, you can incorporate these kind of ideas to your code. So now what you see, what you saw, what I showed before, you have a nice kind of very nice framework for changing from direct numerical simulations to the adaptive LAS framework. And it's simply by changing epsilon, the contribution of your model would be different. In particular, you can simply do adaptive LAS and simply make your epsilon smaller, and the model automatically becomes less significant and basically will turn it off itself. So it's the same uniform framework, very nice. But now, if you want to solve the same problem now, you take, let's say, Reynolds average non-VS toxic equations and try to solve it in unsteady fashion, and you try to solve it on adaptive mesh. So the idea is that eventually, so at this point, we do it as a given equations. You simply solve it, apply numerical method to that. So, and the next step, which we are not there yet, we are start experimenting right now, is how to put all together, provide feedback between unsteady runs, wavelet-based unsteady runs, and the adaptive LAS, and how to do it in systematic fashion. So here's an example of the mean of statistics, mean pressure, mean streamwise vorticity. This is my instantaneous computational mesh, colored by vorticity line, and this is the vorticity itself. And now, here I want to show a couple of things, which is, for some people, it is not commonly known fact, is there are different models which we use. So what I'm showing here is the fact that when people do runs models, more often than not, people simply do, number one, steady state simulations, number two, 2D simulations. So, and when they do that, and if you open the literature, you'll find lots of even 3D run simulations. But what you'll find, 3D run simulations are done with very coarse number of spanwise modes. So here we performed the K omega model and K and Splatter Lamaris models on the same mesh. And I'll show you what mesh it is. But what you see depends on the model. You have different structures. With Splatter Lamaris model, which is very dissipative here, numerical viscosity or turbulent viscosity is very high, you see more or less two-dimensional structures. When you do K omega model, it has behavior similar, it's unstable to three-dimensional perturbation. So, and why? Because the turbulent viscosity is much smaller. So the common assumption that K epsilon model 2D results are the same as 3D results are wrong, number one. Number two, no way you can get the steady state Runz equations to converge to averaged solution. So now, this is the results where I show different results for where you have 2D versus 3D effects. And what you see, we also compare with the conventional Runz approach, which people did. This is, and notice the resolution, 150, 150 by 16 modes in three dimensions versus, you know, order of magnitude more high modes. So what it means, you have to be very careful when you do Runz, but also it gives us the hope to merge them together in the sense that now you see unsteadiness in the unsteady Runz simulations. You can better off come up with these hybrid approaches that you can glue them together because they have some intermittency. Here's an example of the sensitivity when you do the same results for Splatter Lamaris Chi omega, the same resolution, you see the results also are different. So there's a variety of models, and some of them work well in the context of hybrid layers around some node, so which there is a room to investigate. So to conclude, Basically, we develop a nice framework using wavelets for hierarchical wavelets modeling. It has nice control of fidelity of simulations. I mean, the future topic of research, we need to tie it with the UQ, but this framework is nicely integrated with numerics and modeling integrated nicely together. And so the whole idea later on, we want to also control not only the numerical model, but also the anisotropy of the mesh. And if you need more, you can read annual review of fluid mechanics or more papers which were recently published on this website. With that, I'm open for questions.